Hello and welcome to today's webinar after our summer break. My name is Ernst Eder and I'm the LOMAG Technical Director. The topic of today's webinar is ANSI CTA 709.8 High Speed Network Design Guidelines. It is the second part and today we will learn how to design high-speed networks and some technique with actual installations will be shown too. Our speaker today is Masa Konishi from Megachips. Masa is general manager of the networking infrastructure business unit. On the screen now you see the logistics. We have at the end a Q&A session, so feel free to submit questions. It will be answered at the end. The webinar is recorded and will be posted in the next few days. Okay, Masa, it's yours.
Hey, thank you for organizing a webinar, Ernst. Just a sec. Okay. Yeah, good morning to Europe and good afternoon to Asia. My name is Masa Konishi. It's my pleasure to be talking to you today. This webinar is a second part of ANSI CTA 709.8 High Speed Power Line Network and its design guidelines. And part one, I've done in July, is available at the LOMAG website. So please check it if you missed it. So it's the same slide, Ernst is already introduced, let me give you a background. I've been working more than 25 years in the high-tech sector. And in particular in wireline technology. And I'm a general manager at Megachips, networking infrastructure business unit. Megachips is the largest Japanese fabless semiconductor. It's founded in 1990, and the headquarters is located in Osaka, Japan, and San Jose, California. We have a global reach with office and R&D center and distributors and partners. Our revenue is about 600 million US dollar, and we have about 600 employees. So I encourage you to go our website. There is a more detail about the Megachips and its product line. Okay, so here is today's agenda. First, I will go through what I introduced in part one in July. Then two topics will be covered. The first topic, basic and simple factors and the theory for networking design will be presented. And how to estimate the communication range using these factors will be shown. In the second topic, actual network design in practical environment will be discussed, referring these factors and theory. Okay, so let's get started. So this is a recap of part one. ANSI CDA 709.8 is a high-speed and long-range communication channel. It's newly introduced as a PHY and MAC layer of LOM CNP standard. It's also referred as a HDPLC or BPL. That's a broadband PLC. 709.8 is already adopted widely, such as Ethernet, RS-485 extender, HVAC, street lighting, PV panel, video entry system, and so on. Evaluation kit provides necessary hardware and software tools which customers can evaluate its performance under the practical conditions. Here are the characteristics. Two versions are available, Marchop for long range and Complete for higher speed. Throughput is UDP maximum 90 megabps for Complete and maximum 35 megabps for Marchop. The latency is around 2 milliseconds. And the polling access, we can achieve 200 messages per second. And authentication is done in 40 seconds for 200 nodes, and also 30 seconds for 600 terminals. And various means of security is available, like AES-128 and pairwise key, network information key, VLAN, and so on. So these are available. So you can review the part one contents in the Lomac website. Okay. Now I'm going to present basic and simple factors and the theory for network design. Firstly, this is a link budget. Link budget is a budget between transmitter and receiver for communication. The calculate the factors of signal gain and loss. If the gain and loss meets a level required, then communication is possible. The TX power and required CNR and noise and attenuation and deteriorations. These are the factors to calculate the gain and loss. ANSI CTA 709.8 required CINR 0 dB. 0 dB means that as long as noise and signal power is the same, communication is possible. The measurement result of dynamic range 85 dB, which is actually shown in part one webinar, means that minus 10 dB M per 10 kilohertz TX signal is attenuated by 85 dB. And in such scenario, the noise and the signal power becomes the same. That is actually maximum attenuation of the signal being able to communicate. So in case to have a higher throughput, higher CINR means the signal power has to be higher than noise. That is required. Okay. And in practical environment, unlike lab, noise from equipment may exist. That means that this blue area, this will be bigger than this elast. So for instance, assuming that the noise in practical condition, the noise is 10 dB higher, then the attenuation level which communication is possible is up to 75 dB. This is the attenuation to meet CINR of 0 dB. Okay. And in the lab, attenuator is used to reduce the signal power. And in practical, the cable loss and the branch, also reflection, these three factors actually attenuate or deteriorate the signal. The cable loss, this is a phenomenon that signal power gets reduced while the Shinran propagates a cable. And also, as a branch, the signal power is distributed to each path, and the signal gets reduced. And diffraction get reduced, deteriorates the signal. So let's go through the details of this cable loss branch and the diffraction. Cable loss, as I mentioned, it's actually a phenomenon. The signal power gets reduced depending on the cable length, as shown in this plot. The x-axis is a frequency, and the y-axis is a CNR. The plot shows a result of 0 meter to 600 meter with 100 meter steps. The higher frequency signal consumes more power than the lower frequency while propagating the cable. So CINR of higher frequency gets less as cable gets longer. So you can see the higher frequency side CINR get reduced. Seven 709.8 has a 400 subcarrier in signal band to 2 to 28. It needs actually 1/4 over 400 carriers for the communication. So in this scenario, 600 meter has around 1/4. So even if a CINR, the signal is still bigger than noise, if the total subcarrier is less than 1/4, then communication cannot be possible. And just a note, the cable loss depends on its material, means diameter, twisted or not. So cable bender usually provide its frequency characteristics. So you can find how much attenuation occurs for a specific cable. So this is a branch. As shown here, signal is distributed to each path at the branch. So simply, the signal power on each path get half, which means that 3 dB less than the power from the source. And in addition, the diffraction occurs at the branch. It's due to the impedance mismatch. In this simple example, the diffraction causes around minus 1 dB on the signal. So in total, the signal is 4 dB less at the branch point. This 4 dB can be limited to 1.3 dB with a different type of the branch. It's a called Daisy chain and also some simple care. So I will show you how we can limit signal loss to the 1.3 dB later. Next is diffraction. Diffraction occurs at the impedance mismatch point. The light figure illustrates things happen with diffraction in case of an open cable. At the open end, the signal cannot go anywhere and comes back to the source side. The important phenomena is that the amplitude at the 1/4 of a wavelength is always zero. The left plot here shows a typical power spectrum with the impedance mismatch. So as you can see, the signal power gets lower at some specific frequency. So these actually caused by the deflection at the impedance mismatch point. So when it's possible to place a termination on the cable, then you can suppress the deflection, and it's possible to have a robust and a stable network. Means we can suppress these signal deterioration. So, however, even without the termination, thanks to the 400 subcarriers of our OFDM, it's not so critical issue. But still, it's recommended to consider to have a termination. It's because suppressing a deflection is always good to have a robust and stable network. This is a multi-pass fading. It's actually complex version of a deflection. These are actually example of a wireless. The deflection and the diffracted occurs various points while signal is actually propagated. As a result, at the receiver end, the signal is deteriorated. Similarly for wiring, having lots of nodes makes the deflection complicated. So again, deflection occurs at the impedance mismatch point. So it's good to know the impedance of communication path for your network design, even if you cannot control or design it, it's always better what is the impedance in the communication path. So this slide shows the effect of the impedance. This measurement have been done with 400, 220, and 75 ohm load impedance on 100 meter cable with daisy chain. Here, daisy chain means that this branch connection is less than 10 centimeters. As you can see here, 10 equipments are connected, and the signal power from the master is observed at the end of the cable with the termination. The plot shows a result. X-axis is a frequency, and Y-axis is a signal power. The blue one is in case of a load impedance of 400 ohm. And orange is a 220, and gray is a 75 ohm load impedance. Apparently, the signal power get lost when the load impedance is lower. This is because the signal power is distributed more at the branch when the load impedance is less. As you can see here, having higher load impedance at each equipment is better for the robust and stable network. But please know that having higher impedance at each equipment means receiving the less signal power at each equipment. So be sure that each equipment can sustain enough CINR to achieve required throughput. As shown here, cable loss, branch, and the deflections are the three major factors to determine communication quality. So now I will show how to estimate the communication range considering these factors. The first example is the same topology as the previous slide. The network is designed with a daisy chain and a higher impedance. In this case, 400 ohm is employed as an input impedance, and also the branch is limited to 10 centimeters. One hop dynamic range is measured 85 dB. The cable is VVF with a diameter of 1.6 millimeter. In this cable, the attenuation is 0.122 dB per 1 meter at 50 megahertz. The loss at branch is 1.3 dB. It because of the 400 ohm impedance, but the higher impedance together with the termination, we have a 10 dB attenuation as a receive signal. And also assume that the 100 terminal connected to the cable and reserve 10 dB as a guard one for robust and stable communication. The estimated range under this condition is calibrated here. The 10 hop dynamic range, it's calibrated one hop dynamic range of 85 dB minus the guard band of 10 dB and also the attenuation at the input of equipment and multiplied by 10 hop. And each branch has a 1.3 dB attenuation, so multiplied by 100 unit, 100 branch. And then divided it with 0.122 dB per 1 meter. As a result, we can get around 4 kilometers. So this is estimated range with a daisy chain topology. And next one is a bus topology. Similarly, we have a 85 dB dynamic range with a one hop and a 0.122 dB per meter with at the 50 megahertz. And the branch loss is a 4 dB. This is because the branch is a simple branch and the signal is distributed by half and 1 dB deflections. But the input impedance of each equipment is matched to the cable impedance. So there is no input deflections and termination loss. And terminal, again, we assume 100. And for the robust and stable communication, 10 dB is reserved as a guard band. With this condition, the estimated range is calculated here. The 10 hop dynamic range is calculated from 85 dB one hop dynamic range minus guard band multiplied by 10 hop and subtract the 4 dB loss at the branch multiplied by 100 branch and then divided it with 0.122 dB per meter. So as a result, the estimated range is around 3 kilometers. The two examples here, not 4 kilometer and 3 kilometer is not the operational limit. As I introduced in part one, webinar, by making good use of network extension capability, higher throughput, more terminals, and longer range are achievable. Now I'm going to show actual network design with consideration of environment based on the discussion so far. 709.8 is a free topology. It can accommodate whichever the topology is a bus connection, stir, daisy chain, or even combinations. The important thing to take advantage of 709.8 to know the cable characteristics, branch, and the reflections. So knowing these factors can help the designing robust and stable 709.8 network and improving the entire system performance. So here is an example to design network in a big building with a dedicated line. First, to build a closed network on each floor with AC power line. Then to have a vertical network with a dedicated line and connect this dedicated the network with dedicated line and each floor's network with a network extension. In this case, we are assuming that MII connection. This design enables a free topology, robust and stable whole building network. And moreover, installing a low-pass filter helps improving network quality. The low-pass filter suppresses the noise from equipment using this AC power line on each floor. Next one is to use an AC power line even for the vertical network in a big building case. The 100 volt and the 200 volt AC power line is generated at the transformer from the medium voltage and distributed to the breaker box at each floor. And the AC power line is distributed to the each floor and appears at the outlet. The transformers and the breaker box have lots of branch inside. And because of this branch, the signal is attenuated around 20 to 30 dB. The communication signal, for instance, like from here, this outlet to this outlet, the signal is go through the multiple breaker box and transformer. So it's recommended to install a terminal at the breaker and also transformer. The terminal installed at the breaker and transformer work as a hopping mode. So the attenuated signal due to this branch is repeated at the hopping node. So which means that the strong TX power is actually propagated to the next transformer or breaker instead of attenuated signals. So it helps designing a robust and a stable network in a big building. For the breaker circuitry, there is one node. In particular, for the magnetic type breaker, this has actually issues. So because of the coil inside the magnetic type of a circuit breaker, the huge reflection occurs and it deteriorates the signal heavily and the communication becomes unstable. So in order to avoid, install the inductive coupler and bypass the magnetic circuit breaker and have the terminal, the thermal circuit breaker like this. So by having this installation, you can also have a stable network, even with the magnetic breakers. This is an example of a multiple transformer, in Sky High Tower building. With multiple transformers, signal will be attenuated by 40 to 60 dB. So it's not easy to design robust and stable network between transformers with a 709.8 because its dynamic range is 85 dB. So instead of having a 709.8, it is recommended to employ the network extensions. It means to use Ethernet or Wi-Fi for the communication between transformers. And under each transformer, we can have the same network as shown previous slide. The ANSI CTA 709.8 is deployed widely thanks to these flexibility of working complementary with Ethernet or Wi-Fi, as it is stated here. So you can take advantage of 709.8 features like free topology, high speed, long range, and IP enabled. This actually shown in the various applications as introduced in the part one webinars. Okay, so here is a last slide of today's session. The link budget should be considered to design robust and stable network. It's calculated with TX power, required CNR, and noise and attenuations. For CTA 709.8, the TX power is minus 10 dB per 10 kHz. Required CNR is 0 dB, and the dynamic range is 85 dB. The noise is actually depends on the environment, but having a robust filter, we can suppress. The attenuation is caused by cable loss, branch, and reflections. Knowing and tweaking impedance makes communication quality better. Also, analyzing signal paths helps well-planned network and the installations. ANSI CTA 709 is adapted widely by means of network extension with other communications such as Ethernet and Wi-Fi. So actually today's session is a simplified version of Megachip's system development guideline. Further details are described in the further details of termination impedance, topology, and other techniques described in the guidelines. So visit our website, megachips.com. Yeah, and my last comment is this 709.8 is eco-friendly technology. The sharing power line and communication line can reduce the material. So it will be good for Earth and draw attention from that aspect too. So please consider the 709.8 as a future technology. Thank you for your time. That's all for today's sessions.
Thanks, Masa. Very good presentation. If you have any questions, please submit. We got at the moment one here. So the first one is, what is best practice after distance calculation? Means if you calculate 2.8 kilometers, what would be then best practice to calculate for installation, because I guess the 2.8 would be the limit, right?
limit to, with respect to this actually guard band, like merging. So it's, I think, using this cable, it's actually, I would say, almost the same as actual limitation. But in the building, as shown, there might be like breakers or other equipment. So depending on those other factors, it can be reduced, yes. But if you can have a dedicated cable, this estimation is more or less practical number.
Okay, I want to add something here. Is there then, after the installation, for me somewhere to see what the link budget is, if I did the calculation right?
So your question is after installation?
Yeah, exactly. Then if I scan all nodes and see, okay, this one has a good link budget, the other one not, and so for me to validate in the end if my calculation was correct.
Oh yeah, yes. You can check it. Actually, we have a tool to check the CINR of each node. So you can check if this calculation is correct or not. And yeah, right.
Okay. Okay, and then there is another one here. Is there any difference between the power supplies US, Europe, and Asia? Means 50 hertz, 60 hertz, 100, 110, 230 volt?
Of course, you need to think about the tolerance of a voltage. For instance, 240 volt. If you would like to apply 240 volt, you must have a protection for 240 volt. But other than that, there is no difference in terms of communication-wise. 50 hertz, 60 kilohertz doesn't matter, and voltage-wise, it doesn't matter. Actually, not only AC power, but DC power line can be applied. So, yeah, it's only matter of protection. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. So that's all which came in. Yeah, thanks everyone for listening. As mentioned in the beginning, the session is recorded, will be online in the next few days. So you can share it with your colleagues or forward it to others. Also, please check out our website for the next webinars will take place same hours or next week, also on Thursday and the next couple of weeks. Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Orange. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.